God's grace and peace to you, friends. We come together, gather once again to worship and celebrate the good news that we find in the love and life of Jesus Christ. We come to build our relationship with the divine and take care of one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. I invite you to join as we celebrate, as we think, as we take time out of our lives to wonder and to build and to care for this relationship with the divine that we all work toward. Let's worship together.
Rejoice, ye pure in heart. Rejoice, give thanks and sing. Your festal banner wave on high, the cross of Christ your King. Rejoice, give thanks and sing. Bright youth and snow crowned age, strong souls and spirits meek, raise high your three exalting song, God's wondrous praises speak. Rejoice, give thanks and sing. With voice as full and strong as ocean surging breaks, send forth the hymns the saints have loved, the songs of ancient days. Rejoice, give thanks and sing.
Let us pray. We live not by bread alone, but also by every word you speak, O God. Entering your story sometimes feels like biting off more than we can chew. Yet we come back for more, as there's nothing more beautiful or satisfying than the feast you lay before us. Open your stories to us today and give us ears to hear, that we may come in and see your world anew and find our place shining like the sun in your beloved community. Amen. We jump in our story then this week from the Sermon on the Mount and jump several chapters ahead in Matthew to look at a few parables that are both familiar and sometimes a little dense for us. So these come from the 13th chapter of Matthew, verses 24 through 43. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be cared to someone who sowed good seed in his field, but while everyone was asleep, the enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away, so that when the plants came up and bore grain, the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in this field? Where then did these weeds come from?" And he answered, "An enemy has done this." And the slave said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" And he said, No, for in gathering these weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them into bundles to be burned, and then gather the wheat into my barn." Jesus then put another parable before them. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It's the smallest of all the seeds, but when it grows, it has the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air can come and make nests in its branches. And then he told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed with 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened. Jesus told the crowds these things in parables. Without a parable, he told them nothing. This was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet. "I will open my mouth to speak in parables. I will proclaim what has been hidden from the foundations of the world." Then he left the crowds and went into his house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain the parables of the weeds in the field to us." And so Jesus answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. And the weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is at the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send the angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and evildoers, and they will be thrown into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous, they will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen." Here ends our reading of the Gospel of Matthew. What is the kingdom of heaven like? Jesus responds to the questions that must have been asked by his disciples, must have been asked by those following him, by teaching with parables, not a straight answer, of course. A parable is one of those stories that has multiple meanings and multiple ways to interpret, depending on a lot of factors. The Gospel of Matthew tells us that Jesus teaches in this way to A, follow the prophetic calls in the Hebrew Bible, specifically in Psalms, and B, so only those who know him can understand. I want you to note right away, though, that Jesus doesn't say this. This is the author of Matthew telling us that Jesus is being kind of cloaked, using a little bit of subterfuge to teach rather than letting people hear it. I have this very deep-seated feeling that Jesus is actually teaching in parables because it has a lot of benefits in how it teaches. parables have this amazing ability to have multiple interpretations from the same stories, and the meanings can shift depending on the experience of the listener, their background, their profession, what they know, their relationships, and things like this. Each set of parables that can mean something different to a different person and different group. For instance, a Jewish listener is going to hear echoes of the traditional Jewish text. They're going to hear Hebrew Bible things, the stories that they know and love so well. You might find a Gentile, someone who is not part of the faith community, to hear this story, who's going to hear some sort of deep invitation to something different. It also may be that someone who has been excluded from the Jewish community or from the Gentile community is going to hear a place that is less harsh, full of less judgment, that's an invitation to them who have been cast away. And a casual listener may walk by and hear the story and think that Jesus is just telling stories about agriculture and not understand anything that is in there. The beauty of this is that when you approach a parable at different times in your life, through your age and your experience and what's happening around you, it may offer different insights. What you knew when you were 18 may be wildly different than at 30, and then at 50, and then at 70. It may change and grow with you. It may offer deeper insights into things that you had never thought about before, based on so many factors. A farmer is going to hear the story in one way. A banker is going to hear it differently. A teacher is going to hear it differently. A mechanic is going to hear it differently. And that is the brilliance of teaching, specifically with parables. So last week, we talked about Jesus' calling to abundant living, walking this narrow path that is full of lack of judgment, both individually and communally, and this reliance on God's good care, on God's good creation. The section of teaching that we're going to read now comes a few chapters down the line, and Jesus has been teaching and preaching and wandering around with his disciples. And in this trio of parables that are linked together, Jesus actually gives an explanation to a certain extent, or one explanation of what these might mean to his followers. So let's start with the parable of the wheat and the weeds, traditionally known as the wheat and the tares. Jesus tells this story then about a field that is growing with both wheat and with weeds. And as the servants come to the master and say, "Let us weed the field," someone has planted weeds in your good field of growing, right? And the owner says, "You can't pull out the weeds without damaging the wheat. So you're going to have to sort it out at harvest. Let it be." Earlier hearers of this parable likely would have understood this a bit differently. If you're a gardener out there, you will understand that weeds are sometimes the bane of the garden. They steal those good nutrients from everything you want with your creeping Charlie and among other grass, you name it. Nothing inherently bad about them, but it's taking away what you're trying to grow, the good stuff you want to get, your produce and vegetables and fruits and all the delightful things that can come from a garden. But as a gardener, an important task is to root them out. But when you're talking about this, in the case of the wheat and the weeds that this owner's talking about, that Jesus is talking about in this case, you can't differentiate them when they're young. You can't tell the wheat from the weed. And once the wheat grows up and the weed grows up, and you can tell them apart, if you kill the weed and pull it out, you also destroy the wheat. The early people who heard this would have known this because that would have been something they would have seen growing. They would have probably, if they didn't farm themselves, have someone who did that. And they would have known you can't kill one without killing both. And so the essential nature of it is to just let it be. In the parable of the mustard seed, it's a very brief parable, not also to be, I guess, blended with the other story about the faith of a mustard seed that can move mountains, although they are related. In this parable about the mustard seed, it talks about the smallest little seed, and it's seemingly inconsequential, and it does something unexpected and grows into something of great value. Often mustard is planted as a cover crop, basically to be grown, cut down, and turned into compost for the soil for something that's more important or of more value later on. The mustard plant, this great tree or bush or shrub, however you'd like to call it, is something that grows up small and doesn't seem to have any value, and yet it becomes this place of refuge and welcome for the birds of the air, a place for them to have safety. In the parable of the yeast or of the leaven, depending on how you like to call it, this very, very brief parable looks at a woman who takes a small amount of yeast and adds it to the flour, and all of it is leavened. This is an especially poignant story in relation specifically to the people who were Jewish in this, who would have known the story of the Exodus and that unleavened bread before their flight from Egypt. If you're a baker in the group or have tried your hand at baking bread, you know that a small amount of yeast can turn a flour hockey puck into a brilliant, crusty loaf of delicious, airy bread. So why are these stories linked together? Why are we supposed to think about them? Should we think about them as a unit, as individuals? I'm going to say both and. One interpretation, and the one that I tend to go to more often than not, looks at the teachings from last week and kind of in light of this. The teachings about the golden rule and how we're not to judge lest ye be judged. It's about some sort of place where we don't make decisions for others and we worry about our own house and not everyone else's, right? Take care of that speck after you take care of the log in your own. It comes in contrast to what we as humanity like to do. We judge on appearances. We like to separate and define things. These are good and these are bad. And all three of these parables say, not the thing you're supposed to be doing. We're told in no uncertain terms that we are not the reapers of the harvest of wheat and weeds, that we are not the ones that make the call on what is wheat and what is a weed, because, frankly, we weren't the ones created to do that. It's just not our job. Judging of wheat and weed is not our task. In some ways, it's a call to live and let live. Or maybe better said, you don't get to presume. You don't have the right, the ability, or the job to judge who is good or bad. With the parable of the mustard seed, something that seemingly has little value surprisingly serves an important purpose, even though the appearance of the seed leads us to believe that it is unimportant. It's a reminder and a call that from the smallest things in this life, things that seem to have little value, at least as we see it, that value, even great value, can come. Even if it's not necessarily something we value, it may hold value for someone else. And who are we to determine someone else's values? The same is said about the yeast in this way. I'm always astounded that when you make bread, two tiny little teaspoons of yeast, and you have four massive cups of flour, some water, some salt, maybe a little oil, depending on what you're making, can take all of this heavy flour and turn this paste mushy stuff into something unexpected and amazing. And it's such a little amount that changes the big picture. Turns it into something that gives life. Abundant life, because bread, at least in the ancient world, and I would argue even today, bread is life. So the question is, how do we make St. Paul's more like a field with wheat and weeds, with God's guidance rather than our own? How can we exist in a place where we don't judge others so harshly, where we don't separate those we consider to be weeds with those we consider to be wheat? How might St. Paul's look at the smallest of seeds, the smallest of gifts and talents, as it were, to recognize their significance may not lie with what we value, but it may offer great value and importance to someone else, which doesn't make it not valuable? How might St. Paul's look to be a leavening agent, something that will cause all other things to grow and rise in this world? How might we partner with God and with our neighbors in using what gifts we have to create something greater than the sum of its parts? Jesus tells those who want to be righteous, who want to have this right relationship with the divine, to follow the path, to live like these parables teach, so that we might shine like the sun in this kingdom of God. Jesus tells us to listen and then to do something to bring this kingdom of heaven close, so that we all might live this abundant life. So what is this kingdom of heaven? It is a place where all are valued for who they are. It is a place where the judgment falls away. It is a place where small things do amazing things. It is a place where little bits of things can cause great impact. In essence, we're called to walk that path that Christ has led us on, to be wheat and forget about the weeds, to be like the mustard seed, to be like the leaven, and in all things, to live that abundant life and offer that abundant life to all. May it be so with you. Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Let us join together in a time of prayer. In the mystery of your love, you reveal what has been hidden. In the clarity of your teaching, you invite us into deeper wonder. We thank you for the blessing of exploration, the journey of seeking and finding anew your grace in the familiar and in the unexpected. We pray this day for those whose exploration has been curtailed, those who have been closed down and taught to believe that there is only one way to see and to be. We ask for the wind of your Spirit to open hearts and minds with new possibility. We ask for your Spirit to drop seeds of new life, even unseen and unknown. And we ask for the courage to water them ourselves. May little changes make a big difference until there is a place for all to find shelter and a home in your branches. We pray for those this day that cannot imagine an abundance of your stories. For those who long for even a bite of bread and yet there is none. For those who go hungry while down the way we waste food without thought. For those who work long hours to feed others but get paid nearly nothing for themselves. We ask for your Spirit to leaven your people with generosity that we might rise to the occasion, that the abundance you provide might be shared so that all might be fed. Make your beloved community visible on earth, O Lord, and help us shine the light that reveals your love to the world even now. We ask this in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May you be wheat, may you be leaven, may you be a mustard seed, small and insignificant, so that in your growing relationship with the divine, you may shine like the sun and help all around know that they are loved precisely because of who created them. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.